always drew, even as a little kid. I didn't. It was just what I did, but I wasn't really that great at it. More importantly, I always told stories. I just didn't know you could do that for a living until after I got out of high school. A friend of mine had asked me to write a story for him to draw, and I wanted to be a writer. I had no intention of actually being a comic book artist, but I found out pretty early on it's hard to get artists to finish things. And so I decided if I'm going to work with an artist, it might as well be me. And, you know, it takes a doctor 10 years to become a doctor. It takes a lawyer 10 years to become a lawyer. So if it takes me 10 years to learn how to draw, then I'm going to learn how to draw and have fun doing it. And so it took a while, and eventually I got to where people would pay me to do artwork, and then now I'm putting it together with actually telling stories. And I mean, I would imagine whole worlds like hidden within our own world, and I love that idea that you could create the space and let other people experience it through your stories. I've always found that fascinating. One thing I experience with doing art in West Texas is there aren't a lot of resources for being a cartoonist. You know, you can't exactly go get a degree in it at one of the schools here. So I found it hard to learn how to do that, and I would have to travel all over the country to meet other artists and learn how they learned how to draw and how they developed those skills as a storyteller. In 2005, I actually lived in California for about 8 months, and I went to an art school there briefly. And I got to draw with other cartoonists, just sitting down and drawing people in public. And it became like a team effort where they're just trying to, you know, outdo each other, but then by doing that, making each other better artists. And I was, I learned more in that time period than I did in the, you know, 10 years of trying to teach myself before that. I still do that. I still go draw people at coffee shops and restaurants and Walmart. As I developed those skills myself, I decided I would like to pass that on to other people. You know, and the only reason it wasn't where I live is because nobody had stopped and created it. And so I decided, well, that's an opportunity. And I started teaching other people through my stories and through just one-on-one interaction how to be creative and use their creativity to make art and have a voice. And I'm still learning how to do that, how to teach people that, and how to do it myself. And I started doing it with videos and with books and lots of different resources. I started the Lubbock Sketch Club in 2006, and we started with just three artists. And within about a year, we had up to 60 artists every week, sometimes even more than that. I learned a lot of techniques on how to help artists overcome obstacles. And so I've started putting those lessons into YouTube videos and letting people teach themselves all over the world. And recently passed 11,000 subscribers, which I'm pretty happy about. I'm glad to have that many people want to see these videos and pass them on to other people. It's pretty awesome.
Oh, when you're smiling.
It's one of the only storytelling mediums where one creative person can put their vision out there and let it be their vision. Whereas if you've got a movie, it's like trying to paint with an army. You know, it can never truly be one person's vision because there's so many other people contributing to it. But with comics, it's such a unique medium that, you know, only one person starts it and finishes it. You know, they do the whole process by themselves. And I'm intoxicated by that whole idea. One of my comics is called Super Zeros, and I did it as a webcomic for about 2 years. And it's about a group of high school kids that are super zeros. They got superpowers, but they have no common sense. They basically take slacking to superhero proportions. It was an experiment on teaching myself how to write, because even though I started off as a writer in high school, deciding I wanted to write comics, as soon as I started doing the art, I started getting a lot of critiques on how much I didn't know how to draw. And so I stopped writing for the longest time and started teaching myself how to draw. And it's only been in the last 3 or 4 years that I started writing again and learning how do you tell a story that makes people want to stick around and enjoy it. Recently, I did a book called Owls of the Ironwork Isle. It's a steampunk story set in Victorian England about a group of secret agents that find out that somebody's trying to steal London, and they have to find out who and stop them before it's too late. one good cartoon with a strong visual picture and a punchline can do more for an issue than a whole editorial essay. And that's the power of storytelling with comics and with art. It used to be comics were just for kids. That was the idea. And then the comic industry as a whole stopped making comics for kids because they wanted to prove how grown up they were. But now it's healthy. It's a healthy market now where there's comics for everybody out there. I mean, there's comics about, growing older. There's comics about, learning how to deal with death, and as a human, it's not just about people in tights anymore. It can be about anything. Doing comic books and being a storyteller as a long-term thing. Like, my goal is for me to be a successful storyteller by the end of my life. So I've just got to put in the work and keep learning and keep making mistakes and having little successes between now and then. But someday I'll get it right and I'll tell a story that is worth telling.